Keep standing, yeah. Romantics, please, I need you. And how many of you consider yourselves romantic in business when it comes to work? See, that's what usually happens. Okay, you may sit down. Also, if you're standing, if you prefer. Anybody who's only romantic at work but not in their private lives? No. So I'm a business person myself. I come from marketing, but I'm also an unapologetic romantic. And I believe the world would be a better place if we had more romance in our lives. And I'm convinced that we must find and create romance in and through business. Now, when I talk about romance, I'm not referring to those types of experiences that your HR departments need to be worried about. So don't fall in love with your boss or run away with your colleague. No, I'm talking about moments of awe, beauty, and wonder, about magical encounters with strangers, about moments in which our hearts beat faster, in which adrenaline rushes, moments in which we have a desire for desire, moments in which we lose control and fall in love with everything around us. Moments like this one.
Scandals happen all the time. The question is, how do we respond to scandals?
And what will it mean for the wider region? I think one of your children has just walked in. I mean, shifting sounds in the region. Do you think relations with the North may change?
I would be surprised if they do.
You've seen this, right? It's like this now legendary viral BBC interview where the children interrupted the interview. Or moments like this one, when McDonald's corporate Twitter account suddenly began to utter some pretty stark opinions on US President Trump, as you can see here. And, you know, of course it was hacked, which raises the question of whether corporate Twitter accounts only then sound human when they are hacked. So romance is something that disrupts our routines. Romance stretches our souls. But it's also a way of looking at the world. It's a quest for deeper meaning behind the seemingly mundane. We hope to find it in relationships that amount to something that is greater than just the sum of the parts. And we hope to find it in movements where we might feel that we're part of something that is greater than ourselves. Now, what is the difference between the romantic, an idealist, and an optimist? The optimist looks at the glass and says, the glass is half full. The idealist wants the glass to always be completely full. And the romantic looks at the glass and says, oh, isn't this glass beautiful? But it's hard. It's hard to find that kind of beauty in business. This rather grim quote by an Austrian author really nails it, because it says two things. First, without work, we are miserable, most of us, because work is really where we make or break ourselves, where we form our identity, where we find meaning. But the truth is that most of us, according to various studies, also are quite miserable at work. And it's not surprising, because many of us find themselves stuck in corporate structures that, you know, look like this. Innovation and expression. And at the workplace, we are often expected to be flawless, consistent productivity machines. And increasingly, we're now in this fierce and to some degree unfair competition with ever smarter machines, software, artificial intelligence, robots, that on the grounds of efficiency probably outperform us. So what do we do in our despair, knowing that maybe 50% of the human workforce might be replaced by AI and automation in the next 20 years? Well, we turn into smart machines ourselves. And we track everything, measure it in order to optimize it and to maximize it. Hence the rise of so-called people analytics, the quantified workplace. With one extreme aberration being this Swedish company that is implanting chips into the bodies of their employees so they can track every single step and can monitor them throughout the day. Or this app, which is called Don't Worry, Be Happy, and it tracks your facial expressions, your emotions, and if you stop smiling, if you stop being happy in front of a computer, it deletes the entire progress you've made over the past hour. It's not a subtle stimulus, I guess. And this obsession with the quantification, the datification of our lives, has infiltrated the most private, the most intimate aspects of our lives. You know, in business we say you can only manage what you measure, but now it seems that only the measured life is a good life. So there are apps like People that allow us to rate the value of the people in our lives. Or this one, a rather bizarre app called Spreadsheets that lets you enhance your sexual performance based on data analytics. It's not everybody's cup of tea. And if it doesn't work, you can use this service called Breakup Text that lets you send automated breakup text messages. It may come in handy. Or if that's way too messy for you, then you can really control your love life by using this web service called Invisible Boyfriend. There is an invisible girlfriend that's still in beta. Maybe one day it will be released, but Invisible Boyfriend is a web service that sends you fake emails, fake text messages, and even makes fake phone calls. It's a boyfriend your friends can believe in, as the tagline says. Why? Because he's not real, he's fake. So that's what love and friendship look like in the age of machines. And maybe soon we might indeed be falling in love with our operating systems, with our chatbots, as so beautifully portrayed in the movie Her by Spike Jonze. The New York Times wrote about the movie and said, the great question is not whether machines will be able to think. The great question is, will we humans still be able to feel? And indeed, when everything is measured, quantified, made familiar, predictable, convenient, then where do we find these profound experiences that punctuate our routines, that expose us to strangeness, to strangers? Where's the magic? Where is the romance? I believe we are at risk of systematically engineering the romance out of our lives. Romance, which perhaps is the ultimate differential in a world of maximizers and optimizers. Now, we've been at a point of such great disenchantment before. 200 years ago, the original romantic movement, the British romantic poets, the Germans, the French, others, they revolted against the regime of the enlightened, practical, empirical reason, the Enlightenment, and a view of man that was very rational and what they thought were very, very reductionist. So they espoused virtues to revolt, to rebel against that, such as mystery, emotion, inconsistency, suffering, ambiguity, unpredictability. That was the beginning of the romantic movement back then, and I think now we need a new romantic movement. This time we're facing a great disenchantment that is caused by the datification, the quantification of everything. And this time we need a new romantic movement that originates from the heart of business. With you, the creatives in business, serving as the new meaning makers, the new romantic figureheads and poets of our time. But how? That's the big question, right? How do you operationalize romance without compromising the very essence of romance, which is a spirit of rebellion and elusiveness? So how do you actually put that to work without killing it? So in my book, The Business Romantic, I propose 10 design principles for business romance. I call them the rules of enchantment. And I know the title of the talk said there were going to be 4 principles, but for the sake of efficiency, I condense them into 3. So they are waste time, keep the mystique, and suffer a little. Let's start with waste time. So I recently came across an interesting study that says that the average American has only one close friend. and you know, it's easy to poke fun at Americans, especially these days, but the numbers are not very different in Europe and other parts of the world. And in fact, they have deteriorated over the past few years. And experts speak of an epidemic of loneliness, a crisis of friendship, and a crisis of social isolation. And it's strange, isn't it? Because we've never been more connected, never been more communicated than at this point in history. We are glued to our phones 24/7, and yet we are lonelier than ever before. Why is that? The author Richard Bach has an explanation. He says, the opposite of loneliness is not just hyper-connectivity or being together, being connected. No, it's intimacy. And intimacy has really become a very precious good, something that we yearn, that we crave in these digital times. So we're seeing a renaissance of formats, analog and digital formats, that are producing intimacy and serving this need for intimacy. For example, the good old dinner series. There's a series in the US called Let's Have Dinner and Talk About Death, which is a very unlikely invitation you might not want to follow. But 15 strangers meet, break bread, and talk about what it means to die with dignity. Then myself, a few months ago, I took part in a silent dinner, which was a remarkable experience. Business leaders, entrepreneurs, we sat around the table for 90 minutes and didn't say a word. And it felt wonderful. Very tender. Then there's this social experiment called the I Am Here Days. It's run by a friend of mine in New York City. They meet one Sunday a month with the intention to explore one neighborhood of New York City. The rule is, though, no digital devices, no interruptions. You have to commit to spending 8 hours non-stop together, which is incredibly hard because it's boring. When was the last time you spent 8 hours with someone? Really? But the rule is, they call it the adult version of a sleepover for kids. The assumption is that if you spend 8 hours non-stop, you forge more meaningful connections, more intimacy than when you spend 8 times 1 hour. So you're thickly present rather than thinly, efficiently distributed. And this idea of thick presence is something that artists are very, very good at, especially performance artists, like Marina Abramovic. Her exhibition was aptly titled The Artist is Present a few years ago at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. And she sat across from one visitor at a time, I think 5 minutes for each visitor, for a total of 728 hours, including some bio breaks, just staring at each other, celebrating intimacy, thick presence, vulnerability. But how do you translate that to the business world? While there are some really eccentric attempts of doing so, of course they come from the Hollywood Hills. There you can actually, for I believe $30, rent a so-called people walker, who walks with you through the Hollywood Hills for 30 minutes and just talks with you and spends some intimate quality time. But less eccentrically, I believe that at the core of the success of co-working and co-living spaces is this need for intimacy, the room for chance encounters outside of the linear process-driven routines of work. You can be thickly present and run into other people. But corporations as well have begun to embrace and cultivate thick presence. For example, through various mindfulness initiatives. That is a phenomenon that's become quite popular. Yesterday I met the head of mindfulness that really exists at the software company SAP. And it's a huge success there. They have a waitlist of 5,000 employees who want to be trained in mindfulness. Some companies have begun to facilitate thick presence by implementing email moratoriums. Daimler, the German car maker, if you send an email to someone and they're on vacation, and you got a note that says your email has been deleted, please try again in 2 weeks or so. And then, of course, in terms of the customer experience, intimacy and quality time and thick presence have a role to play as well. Zappos, the online retailer, recently acquired, not recently, years ago, acquired by Amazon, they famously reward their customer service representatives for how much time they spend on the phone with each customer. Not for how many calls they can squeeze into 1 hour, not for efficiency, but for how long they stay on the phone with their customer. And then there's this example. very similar to Zappos. It's a Dutch caregiving organization called Birdsong. And a few years ago, they made a radical change. They removed all managers, they removed all hierarchy, and they told the nurses on the front lines to form small teams and empower them to do whatever it takes to serve the patient. Don't think about efficiency, don't divide labor, you figure it out. And here's what happened. Not only did the company grow tremendously, but funny enough, the workers became more efficient. They spent less time on each patient. Why? Because they had more intimacy. They understood the patient better. They were closer to the patient. So all these examples, you might think, oh, this is sort of nostalgia. Are you trying to turn back the clock? But nostalgia is often understood as a longing for a time gone by. But it comes from the Greek, and it means nostos, from nostos algos, I think it means. And it means pain from an old wound. And it describes a longing and aching for something profound, for something essential that we seem to have forgotten in these digital times, for some kind of deep connection. We're longing for these concierges who treat us as unique, individual, subjective human beings, who offer us a personal, not a personalized experience, who offer us an escape path from the iron cage of an algorithmic recommendation engine. And these kinds of concierges are products of brands like Moleskine, for example, celebrating emptiness in an age of digital abundance, or this Japanese bookstore that has only one book on sale every month. It's the pinnacle of intimacy with a customer and exclusivity. And then there's this service, Forgotify, which is a web service that discovers and plays for you the 4 million songs that have never been played on music streaming service Spotify. So it uses an algorithm to fight an algorithmic world and to discover the romance that awaits us at the lonely end of the long tail. So all these moments, they have one thing in common. They are moments, beautiful moments, that don't scale, that cannot be maximized, that cannot be optimized. And if we're honest, those are the best moments in life, the most meaningful moments. And any relationship researcher will tell you that the secret of happy, healthy relationships is not the great gesture, not the lofty promise. It's small moments of attachment, intimacy. We need more of these moments in business. That brings me to rule number two. Keep the mystique. Now, freedom and nature, we're inundated with data, drowning in data, and everybody says radical transparency is, you know, the holy grail. We need to be more radically transparent. And I'm not so sure. I think precisely for that reason, mystery makes experiences meaningful again. One company that really understands that is called Secret Cinema. They are trying to revolutionize the movie-going experience. They offer so-called mystery screenings in surprise locations all over the world. They invite thousands of people to reenact, participate in a movie. And the thing is, they don't even tell people which movie is going to be shown until the very last minute. What's interesting about it is that it doesn't matter what movie they're showing, the secret, the mystery, is the product. Same is true for House of Genius. It's a networking series. Think of it as the anonymous alcoholics of business networking. Everybody remains anonymous. No one reveals their identity. It's a very different way of tackling business issues. And that there are actually also secret societies now popping up at companies such as Accenture or Virgin. Etsy, the e-commerce company for handmade goods, they have a so-called Ministry of Unusual Business. No one knows who's a member, really. No one knows when they meet. But everybody knows their mandate, which is to inject everyday life with some beautiful disruptions at the workplace. So making the familiar strange again, traveling between different worlds, playing with multiple identities, those are not only the traits of the romantic, those are also the features of virtual reality and augmented reality. And maybe you could argue that VR and AR are the new romantic technologies of a new romantic era. The empathy machines that give us access to the lives of others, that tell us that there's always another world possible, there's always another door that will open. And that is very much the essence and the promise of romanticism. And that kind of world will require different skills. It will require empathy, so you can easily commute between worlds. And it will require those people who can imagine other worlds and can design the interfaces between them, which are very often increasingly so conversational. That's why IBM is hiring playwrights, storytellers, screenwriters for their Watson product. That's why the World Economic Forum suddenly highlights that it's no longer just problem solving and quantitative skills, but empathy, emotional intelligence, critical thinking that are going to be skills that are important in the future. And even one profession that was always laughed at in terms of its commercial viability is now suddenly hot, in demand. Philosophers. Philosophers, because they may not know how to solve problems, but they know how to ask the right questions. And they suffer from the world. And that brings us to the third and the last of the rules, which is called suffer a little. Romance is not identical with happiness. Right? There's a dark side to it. We have skin in the game, we lose control. We suffer a little. But that's very counter to the way we design most of our workplace and customer experiences, which are mostly designed for instant gratification, maximum comfort, and convenience. Amazon will soon deliver everything our heart could possibly desire to our doorstep via drop. In Japan, you can already order a priest through Amazon. So convenience is important, it matters to us. But at the same time, why is it that so many of us can't wait and expect a new Apple product with religious devotion? Why do people climb up to the mountaintops of the Alps to see the leading bikers of the Tour de France fly by in 10 to 15 seconds? Why do more than 50,000 people embark on this annual pilgrimage to the Black Rock Nevada desert to celebrate Burning Man, a festival of week-long radical self-expression and essentially losing control of yourself? So when you talk to evolutionary psychologists, they will tell you that our brains are still wired for the Stone Age. That we're still looking for these life-threatening, existential, critical events that give us a sense of fitness, that make us feel come alive in the face of danger. However, we have all but banned them from our modern domesticated society. Thank God. But we need them to find meaning to come alive. So what do we do? Well, we create surrogate experiences. We go bungee jumping, we go skydiving, we run ultra marathons, or we go to IKEA. IKEA has perfected the art of making its customers suffer. It has perfected the art of frustration. It's a labor of love. If you go to an IKEA parkour, it's like a seventh circle of hell. If you're like me and you try to self-assemble a Billy Oslo clip-on piece of furniture, it's basically a reminder of your own existential incompetence. The same principle, researchers call it the IKEA effect, is at work in any customer loyalty program like frequent flyer miles, because you never cash in. Right? It's always about delayed gratification, permanent unfulfillment. A very romantic feature indeed. And by the way, that's also at the heart of any viral marketing campaign. It's always a violation, and there's always a little bit of suffering. It's either a cognitive violation of a mental model, something happens that you would not expect. Or it's a physical suffering, like in the case of the Ice Bucket Challenge, and that creates a conversation, disrupts our routine, creates meaning and shared, goes viral. Well, there's an interesting study you may have heard of, an ethnographic study that was conducted among members of tribes in the island of Mauritius. And they found that members of the tribes performing rituals have put metal skewers in their cheeks reported higher degrees of happiness than those who didn't. And there's a business equivalent to that. A study by Harvard that observed that people who perform rituals and have to overcome obstacles before they buy a chocolate bar, that they ascribe a higher value and are willing to pay a higher price for that chocolate bar. So the more we suffer, the more meaning we find, the more attachment we develop. And of course, I would be dismissive if I didn't address one particular species that is very, very good, very adept at suffering and passion. That is the football fan.
De boy, domare, scominata, scominata, domare, chiusa di notte.
So wonderful. So this is the epic win of Iceland against England during the World Cup, a very legendary commentary. And two things come to mind. First, gosh, as long as we're able to feel that kind of passion, we don't have to be worried about robots. But secondly, also, what can we learn from football, actually, in terms of winning and losing? What I find really interesting about football is that any true fan will tell you that it's not just about winning and losing, or not just about winning, it's about how you win. But it's also about how we lose that creates the loyalty and the attachment to a club. In business, however, we are conditioned to win. That's what we learn at business school. Just look at all the management literature, how to win at everything. Wish I had read that. But I argue that in the future, losing will become a core competence. It will become an essential leadership trait. Because we're going to lose more often. First of all, we're going to lose the security and the concept of the full-time 9-to-5 office worker. That's probably going to be extinct in 20, 30 years. But even before that, we're going to lose more often because we're going to form ad hoc teams, we're going to commute between multiple identities, we're going to work in the gig economy, we're going to zoom in and out, we're going to move from one project team to another. We have to learn how to let go. We have to develop rituals of separation. We have to become better at losing. And that's, I really think, an essential leadership trait going forward. So those are the three rules of enchantment. Waste time, keep the mystique, and suffer. And I believe that they illustrate a broader shift from a smart, connected age to a new romantic era where different sets of principles, qualities, and virtues are going to become important. I think we're moving from reacting to wondering, from connection to reconnection, from dashboard to principles, from monitoring to letting go, from variety to serendipity, from big data to big intuition, from real-time to preemptive, intuitive behavior, from behavioral targeting to presence, from conversation to silence, from transparency to mystery, from calculated risk to vulnerability, from reliability to ritual, from user-centric to passion-driven, from convenience to frustration, and from efficiency and excellence to meaning and significance. And the tenets, the four tenets of the romantic company as I envision it, are to dream big, to be foolish about the dreams that you dream, like a romantic dream, to do good, to give back to the community, to feel good, make your customers and employees feel good, but maybe most importantly and most underappreciated, to feel more, to bring your full self to work, not just the positive emotions, not just happiness, convenience, but all of our emotions. And for the romantic leader, that means that it's not going to be an expert anymore, it's an amateur. You know what amateur means? Literally, lover of things. An amateur is someone who does things for the first time and therefore does things with great passion and intimacy. The romantic leader is also a convener, creates community. The idea that you're part of something that is greater than yourself, and of course he's a great storyteller. One of these romantic leaders is Elon Musk. I was recently at a conference where he was asked, somewhat critically, someone asked him and said, well, Elon, this is all great, now you want to colonialize Mars. But isn't that just almost like immoral and obscene? We have so many problems on Earth. You have the capacity and the resources to address them. And instead you want to go to Mars. And Elon Musk said, well, I don't want to solve all of the world's problems, all of humanity's problems. I just want to think of the future and not be sad. And he said, inspiration is underrated. And I think those are really the words of a romantic. They're not problem solvers, they're dreamers. But, in case you wonder, there is an ROI of romance. First, it's innovation. If you don't have romantics, rebels, fools in your organization to see the world as it is not, but could be, then I don't think you can be disruptively innovative. Second, customers. If you want customers who not only appreciate you, but fall in love with you again and again and again, then you have to give them more than just solutions to problems. But if you ask me as a romantic, what is the ultimate ROI of romance? Frankly, I wouldn't measure it in financial terms. For me, the ultimate ROI of romance is more romance. And that is so important because we live in an age of dissonance. On the one hand, we're more connected than ever, but we're also lonelier. On the one hand, we live in an age of abundance, but the prevailing sentiment of our time seems to be one of loss. We seem to be losing the middle, the center, stability, maybe our story, a sense of identity, maybe even our human agency in light of AI and automation. And this is why it's so important that we build and cultivate and nurture organizations that are more like gardens, not like machines. Organizations that cultivate and celebrate those qualities that are inherently human, that make us feel at home. Qualities that machines, at least yet, cannot simulate. Character, acumen, spirit, imagination, hope, and of course heart. And if it is true that software eats the world, as the venture capitalist Marc Andreessen famously said, then maybe the greatest disruption of our time is to maintain our humanity. And if it is true that software is cheating the world, fake news and so forth, then maybe we must insist on a deeper emotional truth rather than just an objective data-based truth. And in closing, I would encourage you to use and apply the three big exponential technologies of our time: AI, digital platforms, and immersive experiences like VR and AR, not just to scale efficiency, not just to enable growth, but to foster intimacy, to create beauty and mystery and solidarity. Romance, to me, is the answer to two pivotal questions. First, against the backdrop of AI, what actually makes us human? And two, against the backdrop of efficiency thinking, what is it that actually makes us unique? As a team, as an organization, as a brand, as a society, as a nation? Romance. So fight for your right to romance. It's really a human right. Let's appreciate and value again what we cannot measure. And let's use data not just to demystify, but to mystify. And let's design for friction and not just for convenience. We romantics, we don't have the answers to all of our questions. We don't have solutions for all of our problems. We don't even want to cure all of our pain. We just want to feel more. And business is our ultimate adventure. Thank you.